Hey everybody, happy new year, happy 2017. Pastor Greg here. I'm excited about life and life is still good. It keeps getting better all the time. There's so many wonderful things happening this month at CSC, and the one thing that I want you to know about today is our Momentum Prayer Call. It started last week and is going all month through February 3rd. It starts at 7 a.m. and if you're on our mailing list, you've already gotten the information on how to access the call. If you're not on our mailing list, we'll go to our website, www.celebrationsc.org. Click connect to join our mailing list and you'll get all the info. Also, if you're on Facebook or you're following us on Facebook, all the information is there. We're knowing the truth for our community. We're knowing the truth for ourselves individually, for CSC, and for our world. It is a powerful time. Additionally, it's a new month, which means we have a new message series, What is New Thought? Looking at the founding principles and the history of New Thought. Let's get into today's message. Oh, let's just take a breath. Breathe in and release. Good morning, Celebration Spiritual Center.
Good morning.
How are you? Good. Well, happy 2017 yet again. Thank you, Lavanda, for giving us the synopsis for our series this month, What is New Thought? Pastor Yolanda and I thought it was very important for us to deal with this series at this time. As we started CSC, we sort of had a focus on, we were looking to attract those who were looking for what we were about. And so we very specifically always use the words New Thought, as we are part of the New Thought movement, and we're really seeking those who were a part of the New Thought movement, who were looking for a New Thought church in Brooklyn. And over the years, as we are now almost 4 years old, we found that we've attracted so many different people, and many people are asking us the question, well, what is New Thought? We love CSC and we love what this is, but I've never heard of New Thought or the New Thought movement. And so we knew it was important to begin the year in this way, and we knew it was important to begin this year to really bring us not only to the history of the New Thought movement, but to the foundational principles of the New Thought movement, which continue to guide us. And so I want to take you on a journey, and I want to take your mind to what was taking place in this country in the mid to late 19th century. And it's interesting how ideas begin to spread. You know, we live in this modern age, ideas spread very fast because somebody can put an idea out on YouTube and it goes viral and everybody's singing beans, greens, tomatoes, potatoes, right? Right? Like, it can happen that fast. Like, it's really quick, right? In this day and age, right? But before the age of the internet, right, it took some time. And so, actually, before we even think about the mid to late 19th century, it's important to look at something that happened in the Western, few things that happened in the Western world. First, it was in the 1750s that the first copy, the first version of the Bhagavad Gita and the Upanishads was actually translated into English. Now, this is important because to the Western mind and the Western world, everything was Jewish, Christian, or Islamic. Right? And we did not know or did not have the influence of the Hindu tradition, the Vedic tradition, right? That really didn't exist. And so in 1753, we get the first English translation of the Bhagavad Gita, right? And so again, as it takes time for these ideas to permeate, what happens in then the mid to late 19th century, right? We're talking about now the 1820s and 30s into the 50s, is where we get the birth of the transcendental movement or the transcendentalist movement, right? Now, who's a part of the transcendentalist movement? One of the most famous members would be Ralph Waldo Emerson. And then we have one of my personal favorites is Henry David Thoreau, right, and the author of Walden, and he actually speaks of the Bhagavad Gita in Walden. And so what we find is that through this transcendentalist movement, which was a philosophical movement, it was an intellectual movement, and also a spiritual movement, they began to see and understand the parallels between the teachings of Jesus, not necessarily the teachings of Christianity, but the teachings of Jesus and the Vedic tradition, what they were also reading and seeing in the Upanishads and in the Bhagavad Gita. Now, what's very interesting as we go even deeper, we find that the very Vedic tradition, the Hindu tradition, is actually quoted in the Gospels, right? When we have in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God, that's actually Vedic. That actually comes directly out of the Hindu tradition. And so we find that connection was always there, but you don't know until you know, right? And so, again, in the 1820s and the 1830s, we have the Transcendentalist movement, which began to look at spirituality and religion and philosophy in a different way, and it created an intellectual movement. It's said by many that this is really the first true intellectual movement that was birthed in the United States, right? We've had others since then, but this was the first. And this group of people, all of this movement took place in New England, all took place in and around Harvard. Okay, and so out of that movement, they influenced many different people, and there are a lot of different seekers. Now, we also must understand that one of the first Hindu gurus that visits the West is Swami Vivekananda, who comes to the West in 1853. So now we're talking about, again, towards the end of the 19th century. We gotta understand what was happening, that all of a sudden this new spirituality, right, of Hinduism, which is ancient, old, all of a sudden these words and ideas are starting to be read, and those who were raised Christian are seeing parallels and beginning to bring them together. But then also now these gurus are starting to come over and teach, and they're filling up halls and filling up rooms, and people are interested and they want to hear what's going on. Meanwhile, what's happening is people are being healed. Not through the Transcendentalist movement, but people are being healed all over the country. Now, it started with this guy named Mesmer. And this guy named Mesmer is where we get the word mesmerism, right? And he had developed this technique where he could convince people of their healing, essentially, right? And so they were mesmerized, right? Now, what he thought then, he had these special magnets that he used to use. And he thought the power was in the magnets, that because of these magnets, when I talk to people and I talk about their illness and I use these magnets and they're healed. But one day he forgot his magnets and he had to go heal some folk. And the people were still healed. And that's when he realized that the healing took place in the mind and had nothing to do with the object. And so there are three names, three people that I want you to remember and know about, because these are three very important people to the New Thought movement. Now, the first is who's considered the father of the New Thought movement, Phineas Parkhurst Quimby. Quimby was a student of Mesmer, right? But what's interesting about Quimby is that he had already healed himself. He had tuberculosis. Back then, tuberculosis was a death sentence. It could not be healed. It was just a death sentence. It was over. If you had tuberculosis, you were done. And he tried all the different medicines and went to the different doctors, and nothing was working. And he talked to a friend of his, and a friend of his said, "Well, I heard that if you go horseback riding, that'll help you heal." And because he wasn't feeling too well, he couldn't go horseback riding, but he decided to do a horse and carriage instead. And he healed himself. He was completely healed. And so he realized there's something going on. He didn't know completely what it was, but he knew something was going on, and that's what sent him to go study with Mesmer, right? And he began to study with others and began to understand this mind-body connection. Because really what was happening, if we understand vibration, that out of joy, all things come. So he enjoyed his carriage rides, right? He found something that took his attention off of the dis-ease and put him into a place of joy and well-being, and he healed himself. That's what happened. That's the principle, right? And so Phineas Parkhurst Quimby opened his first office of healing in 1859. But again, what we must understand is that all of what was going on, these are Christian folk. Right? And I think that's incredibly important, because many times as we look at the New Thought movement and we look at how it is today, because New Thought very specifically, as we teach from many different texts, and you know, I'm always pulling from here, there, and the other, and I'm ordained as an interfaith minister, what we must be very clear about is that the roots and the origin of New Thought is unapologetically Christian, but it's also unapologetically influenced by all of these other traditions, right? It's very important for us to understand that, because I know that many of us, you know, are here because of issues with Christianity, right? Or church hurt, right? And so we want to shun and push away the Christian roots. But in truth, New Thought is founded, deeply rooted in Christianity, because the teachings of Jesus, I love Brother Ishmael Tate says that the teachings of Jesus is New Thought. The teachings of Paul, that's Christianity. Very different. right? Very different, right? So we can throw away the dogma, we can throw away the religiosity, but let's be clear. Our elder brother Jesus is the way shower, right? And so we look at his demonstration to learn how we can also demonstrate in the same way, not to worship him, not to put him up as someone better than us, but to recognize, as he said, greater things than these will you do also, right? In other words, he's like, we're equals, y'all. You my people, right? So Phineas Parkhurst Quimby taught another woman, that's the second name that I want you to know, Mary Baker Eddy, right? Now Mary Baker Eddy also healed herself. She began to study with Quimby, and this was in 1862. And it's said, again, we're talking late 19th century, but it's said that at the time that she came in contact with Quimby, after, you know, hearing about all of these healings and what was going on, they said she was virtually an invalid. This was her condition. She was virtually an invalid. But she got wind of this truth and began to study this truth. And they say that her healing happened quickly. Within a week, she was able to climb 180 plus stairs at the city hall. But she was virtually an invalid a week ago, and now she can climb stairs. Because she got a hold of this new thought teaching. This teaching that there's a power within her, this teaching of what we call affirmative prayer and spiritual mind treatment, this teaching of the power of affirmations, this teaching of the fact that God is not judging you and not mad at you and not testing you through your infirmity, or testing you through your not having a job, or testing you through whatever's going on in your relationship. She got hold of this thing. She tried it for herself, and she was healed. Now, Mary Baker Eddy is important because she also founded one of the denominations that's a part of New Thought, Christian Science, right? And something we're gonna touch on a little bit more, but it's something incredibly important to know that I love about New Thought, is why we did, a year before last, we did the Women of New Thought series. That women have always been at the very beginning of the New Thought movement. And again, I think that's incredibly important and incredibly beautiful. Then we have a third name. So we have Phineas Parkhurst Quimby. He's the father of the movement. Mary Baker Eddy, founder of Christian Science. And then Mary Baker Eddy had a woman that worked with her in Christian Science. She did a lot of things. She's a brilliant writer and wrote many things within the Christian Science movement. Studied under Mary Baker Eddy, and her name is Emma Curtis Hopkins. Now, Emma Curtis Hopkins is important, and she is the mother of the movement because she's called the teacher of teachers. Because what Emma Curtis Hopkins did, she was just a brilliant person. I mean, from a young age, she was just smart and brilliant. But not only that, she embraced these teachings, and she had a way of teaching these teachings that just turned people on. Turned people on so much that she is the teacher of Charles and Myrtle Fillmore, who went on to create the Unity Church. So much so that she's the teacher of Melinda Kramer, who went on to start Divine Science. So much so that she's the teacher of Ernest Holmes, who went on to create the Center, well, now Centers for Spiritual Living, but the Church of Religious Science. She's the mother of the movement. She also taught H.M. Lee Cady. You've heard me reference H.M. Lee Cady many times. Lessons in Truth is one of my favorite texts. It's considered the textbook for the Unity Church. Dr. Emma Lee Cady, again, another powerful woman at the beginning of the movement. She was one of the first female physicians in this country. Just, I always love that. She was a powerful woman anyway, right? But then she wrote this text that we still use today, that within Unity, it's fascinating because Charles and Myrtle Fillmore, as they created the Unity Church movement, first they weren't interested in creating a church. They wanted to create a space for people to study, to know these truths, and then either go to their own churches and continue to live or live out their lives. Ernest Holmes, same thing. It was never really a desire to create churches, but we love to organize and we love to, you know, form community. And so eventually churches came out of all of these teachings. But what's interesting, Charles and Myrtle Fillmore, as they were bringing people together and people were learning and having profound experiences and healings are happening, they realized we need some kind of text. And they just happened to get this manuscript from a woman named H. Emily Cady. And Charles Fillmore said, there's our text. They had never met her at all, but they heard and knew the power of her words. These three names are the three most important names. We could go on because, again, each one taught others and taught others and taught others that brings us to this point today. I've been researching it, and I haven't found the direct link yet, but with Florence Scovel Shinn. We know Florence Scovel Shinn, The Game of Life and How to Play It. I don't know who her teacher was. What I do know is that Mary Baker Eddy, Emma Curtis Hopkins, all came to New York at different times and taught a lot in New York. And so as Florence Scovel Shinn was in New York, I believe that she had to have at least attended lectures by one or both of these. And again, she got a hold of that truth and began to write these powerful texts as a result. But as we look at their lives, Phineas Parkhurst Quimby, again, healed himself, tuberculosis. As we look at Mary Baker Eddy, healed, she was virtually an invalid, right? As we look at H. Emily Cady, and if you look at her story, there's so many wonderful demonstrations of the power, whether it's a demonstration of money, whether it was demonstrations of healing, it goes on and on and on, right? We have these powerful people, and the one thing that I love about New Thought and the roots of New Thought is that at every level, what I find is that they tried it for themselves. They demonstrated the power of the teaching. And as I thought about that, it reminded me of this text in the book of Matthew. There's a story in the book of Matthew where Jesus is encountered by two blind men. It goes like this. And Jesus passed on from there, and as Jesus passed on from there, two blind men followed him crying aloud, "Have mercy on us, Son of David." When he entered the house, the blind men came to him and said to them, "Do you believe that I am able to do this?" Hear that question again. They said, "Have mercy on us, Son of David." They were blind. And Jesus responded by saying, "Do you believe that I am able to do this?" They said to him, "Yes, Lord." Then he touched their eyes, saying, "According to your faith, be it done to you." And their eyes were opened. Now, this is an incredibly telling story. And I still remember when my New Testament professor challenged us with this story in seminary. Because see, the way I was raised, it was that, well, if I'm healed, it's because the power of God healed me. If there's a financial blessing that shows up, it's because the power of God rained money down in my life. But he said, look at the text. Jesus asked a question. Jesus didn't say, well, because I'm Jesus and I have all power, be you healed. That's not what he said. He said, do you believe? If you look at other translations, it said, would you be healed? It's a yes or no question. Do you believe? Would you be healed? And they said, yes, Lord. He touches them. They're healed. Their eyes are open. But what does he say? According to your faith. The power was never in Jesus. The power was in their own thought, their belief. And this is the heart of New Thought. Again, this is why I say it's unapologetically Christian and unapologetically interfaith. Because at the heart of New Thought, we come to this understanding, this knowing, that out of our own pattern of belief, we can be, do, or have anything. And so then the opportunity is for us to then study and to learn what that means, because what makes New Thought beautiful and powerful and unique is that what we teach and we know is that there's a definite scientific path to achieve these results. This is why we continually hear divine science, science of mind. Reverend Ike, the science of living. And this is also why I say it was also it was rooted in an intellectual movement. There was an understanding that we're dealing with universal laws, right? Not universal hopes. We're dealing with universal laws, not universal wishes. We're dealing with universal laws, not universal begging. And so we have an opportunity as we understand and are learning these principles of new thought. Many of us have a lot of knowledge. It's one of the things that can trip us up with a new thought. It's one of the things I love about new thought, right? That there's a zillion and one books, right? A zillion and one textbooks. But for many of us, all we do is amass the knowledge. We can quote Ernest Holmes, but we haven't demonstrated Ernest Holmes. We can quote Michael Beckwith, but we haven't demonstrated the words that Michael Beckwith has given to us. We can quote Eckhart Tolle, but we haven't demonstrated Eckhart Tolle's awareness and knowingness. These people are not unique. I love looking at the story of Eckhart Tolle or looking at the story of Byron Katie. Again, this new thought story continues over and over again that they had these profound experiences that allowed them to be able to heal themselves by thinking a new thought about themselves. Byron Katie, we ask four questions, which helps us to shift our thinking as we begin to think a new thought. She got up off of the ground, out of her stupor, out of her depression, and now she's working all over the world, inspiring and empowering others from asking four questions, from the power of her own thought, from the power of her own belief. And so here and now, in this moment, we have this opportunity to not just amass the knowledge. For some of us, it's time to take the next step. We've been coming to CSC week in and week out, and we haven't attended a class yet. The God Talk is free. The affirmative prayer class is free. If you don't take any other class this year, you need to be in that affirmative prayer class. Because this is the roots of new thought. In affirmative prayer, where do I go? I start with H.M. Lee Cady. You need to know who and what God is. And H.M. Lee Cady is one of the baddest I know to take us right there to understand who and what God is. Right? We don't say that God is just all knowing. God is all knowledge. It's a different way to think about God. God is not loving. God is every expression of love that we can see and don't see on the earth. God is love itself. God is not just omnipresent everywhere at all times. It's omnipresent. In other words, it's constantly encountered. It's everything. And so in order to think a new thought, in order to believe, in order for it to be done according to your faith, you might have to get a new God concept. You might have to come into a new awareness of who and what God is. That's step one in the affirmative prayer. You might have to let go of that old conditioning that had God in a mountain, that old conditioning that had God judging you, that old conditioning that God was vengeful and jealous and hardens people's hearts. You might need to get rid of that old conditioning. But know that there's nothing wrong with you. Know that you're not bad. Even if what you're experiencing right now is a result of your thoughts, it's not that you're bad. It's not that something's wrong with you. It's simply that you're just a product of some negative thinking. It reminds me of that scene, one of my favorite movies, but the scene in The Wiz when Dorothy helps Scarecrow get down from the pole, right? And you know, the crows, you know, they're saying you can't win and all of that, right? And she says, I'll help you get down. And of course, what happens? As she helps him to get down, he stumbles and he falls. And he's like, I'm just a hopeless failure. And what does Dorothy say to him? She said, you're not a failure. You're just a product of some negative thinking. That's all it was. The Wizard of Oz is a new thought story. I don't know if y'all knew that. We did that series already. It's new thought, it's this, right? And I mean, if we look, of course, as you look into the history of L. Frank Baum, he comes from the same tradition of thinkers, right? Influenced and inspired by all of these same words, all of the same rich philosophy. And so there was a powerful thing, as I said, happening in the late 19th century that brings us up to today. And as we said in the synopsis that, you know, new thought influences everything, all things Oprah, right? Right? And it's literally true. I remember hearing recently that one of the things that Oprah requires in every room of her home and in all of her offices is a copy of the Daily Word from the Unity Church. Everywhere she goes on the planet, she has the Daily Word. She has new thought teachings with her. So is it any surprise that her life outpictures in the way that it does, and that she supports the teachers that she does, and that she supports the thinkers that she does, and she lives her life in the way that she does? Is it any surprise? Her mentor, Maya Angelou, was a member of the Unity Church. New thought. And Maya Angelou, I'm sure many of you have seen the video, it's gone viral many times. When she came to that understanding and that idea that God loves me. See, this is what we're talking about. As soon as you come to that understanding, that new thought changes your life. It is impossible for God to judge you because God is love. Love cannot judge. It's impossible. Even in the scripture, in Corinthians, it says it holds no record of wrongs. In the book of Psalms, we have that wonderful passage that we see many times in the book of Psalms. His mercy, mistranslated, but his mercy endureth forever. Mercy, the translation of that word is loving kindness. God's loving kindness endures forever. Loving kindness and judgment are two different things. They can't exist. And if loving kindness endures forever, that's all that is. That's all that's ever coming to us from the mind of God. But now we have to try it for ourselves. And again, for each of us, that can look a little different. For some of us, it may be time to attend the class. For others of us, it may just be time to, we've been in enough classes and it's time to start practicing, putting it in motion. Maybe it's time to just work with one book this year. Just one. Whole bunch of other books are gonna come your way. I mean, we are always offering new books through our series, but you don't have to read it. Work with one book for the year. It reminds me of what Pema Chodron says, right? Pick a path, any path, and go deeper. Pick a book, any book, and go deeper, right? And so what I've come to understand, and this is the last thing I'll leave you with, I've been seeing a lot of things, I think, because it's the new year. You know, lots of things we can do for the new year and how to make our lives, how to be more successful in the new year. And one of the things that I've seen that shows up often on my timelines and in different blogs that I read is, you know, what are the things that successful entrepreneurs do? And what are the things that make a successful person? Or what do millionaires do differently? Or how do they think differently? And there are, you know, many different lists and things. But one thing that I find a commonality is the ability to take risk and the ability to even be comfortable with risk. And it reminded me of a message I gave way many, many, many years ago when I was in seminary. And it was inspired by the title of a book from a wonderful scholar, James Cone, who's the founder of Black Liberation Theology. And there was a collection of his essays and works called Risks of Faith. And it reminded me that whether we're talking about the two blind men, or if you look at the story of the woman with the issue of blood, who none of the doctors could save her, none of the doctors could fix the situation. She heard about this man named Jesus. She heard about these healings that were happening. And she believed, thought, that if I could just touch the hem of his, just get as close as possible, just to touch the very tip of his robe, of his garment, that I could be healed. And of course, we know, according to the story, she was healed without having a conversation with Jesus, without Jesus pouring oil over her and praying 1,000 holy words. He felt the healing happen and he said, "Who touched me?" His disciples looked at him like he was crazy because they were in a crowd of people. They were like, "Master, we're here with like hundreds of people. I don't know who touched you. Anybody could have touched you." Right? And again, we have in that encounter the same idea of your faith made you whole, made you well. Same thing, because she had a thought, which actually didn't make sense, right? Like, did you think you could be healed by touching somebody's garment? Again, the action of it itself wasn't the healing. It was the thought that inspired the action that creates the healing. So I invite each and every one of you to think about, what is your risk of faith today? Where are you willing to now step out? step out in the same way that Phineas Parkhurst Quimby stepped out and rode around in a carriage and healed himself of something that couldn't be healed, supposedly. Step out in the same way that Mary Baker Eddy stepped out and from being a virtual invalid, walking around all over the world and creating a movement through Christian Science. Are you ready to take a risk of faith? To no longer just stand in the amassing of knowledge, and no longer even stand on depending on someone else's knowledge to heal you, but recognizing that you are no different than any of these people who we honor and we love and I cherish and we still read and are influenced by their words. We love them, but we recognize that they were flesh and blood human just like we are. No different. No different. And so our opportunity and our challenge this year is to start to practice the principles. As we move throughout this month, we're going to talk more specifically about what these principles are. What are the foundational beliefs? But I think it's important that first we just understand who our spiritual ancestors are. Understand the company that we're keeping. As I talked about the fact that women have always been at the front of the movement, Emma Curtis Hopkins, she created a seminary in Chicago. And the first graduating class, 20 of the 22 people that graduated were women. Powerful, amazing, spiritual women have always been a part of the movement. Now, it gets even deeper than this, because those same women, including H. Emily Cady, were part of the suffrage movement. So they took what they knew to be true and went out in the world and changed and transformed the world. Think about that as we're standing in this place that we're in right now in our country. Don't tell me that New Thought doesn't have any power. We're not burying our heads in the sand. But we recognize that out of a knowingness, out of a truth, out of knowing who and what we are, then we can stand and expect the world to respect us. But you can't do that if you don't know who you are. You can't. It's empty. It doesn't work. But we see these powerful women, not only were they a part of the spiritual movement, but they were a part of a wonderful, beautiful activist community that ultimately led to women having the right to vote. So you're in good company. Your spiritual ancestors are powerful. And on that, I invite everybody to stand. As we take a breath, Mother, Father, God, I stand here in gratitude. I stand here in gratitude for our spiritual ancestors. There are so many people, known and unknown, named and unnamed, as we have named some today. I also call on the name of our dear, amazing, powerful teacher, Johnny Coleman, and I call on the name of Mary Tumpkin, and I call on the name of Barbara King, and I call on the memory of so many brothers and sisters who have been a part of this movement, that have contributed their life and contributed their intellect and contributed their knowing and contributed the very, very demonstration of their lives to show what is possible. Through their lives, we see that patriarchy can't stand against this teaching. Through their lives, we see that segregation can't stand against these teachings. Through their lives, we see that community and unity and harmony must come together and must be the outpicturing of our lives as we hold on and practice these truths. I am so grateful and thankful to be a part of this powerful movement. I am so grateful and thankful to be a part of a movement and a part of a spiritual center and a spiritual community that is choosing to know this truth in the 21st century, that is choosing to evolve this truth in the 21st century. I am so grateful and thankful to be the new expression of New Thought. And so as I am here with my brothers and sisters, powerful creators within their own rights, powerful beings within their own right, I stand in agreement with them and I stand in alignment with them as we choose to take a risk of faith. as we choose to now put our knowledge into practice, as we choose not to just talk about the principles, but be the principles, as we choose to not just read the principles, but allow the principles to permeate our very being, to now allow the principles to show up in our speech, to now allow the principles to show up in our relationships, to now let the principles now show up on our jobs, to now let the principles show up when we're walking on the street, to now let the principles show up when we go to the hospital, to now let the principles show up when we visit the doctor, to now let the principles show up when we receive a diagnosis, to now let the principles show up when we look at our bank account balance, to now let the principles show up when it's time to pay rent, to now let the principles show up when it's time to pay another bill. We choose to no longer live in intellectual exercises, but we choose to live in a knowingness and a demonstration of this truth. Because what I know to be true is that this world needs more demonstrators. This world is looking for more examples of hope, of possibility. This world is looking for more examples to show that healing is possible, to show that overcoming is possible, to show that victory is possible, to show that there is no circumstance that can keep us down. And so, as we are choosing to be the demonstration of this very truth that we embrace, we walk forth out of this place in love, in joy, and confidence, because we know that we do not walk alone. And so I release this word with much expectation, and I release this word with much anticipation. And together we lift up our voices and we say, amen.
Amen.
Ashe.
Ashe.
And so it is.
So it is.
So it is.